Hey everybody, this is Michael again, and welcome back to my channel here on YouTube. Well guys, I'm continuing to take a look at the films based upon the novels of Stephen King. Funny thing is though, from the earliest Stephen King film, and I think the first Stephen King movie that I saw was back in the 70s as a little kid, and I believe it was Carrie. Carrie was the first film that I saw by Stephen King. And then I think it was Salem's Lot. And ever since then, you know, ever since Stephen King, ever since they started making films based upon his novels, it's just a never-ending thing. They're still doing it today. And as a matter of fact, I think I read an article that said that if any of you remember the miniseries called The Stand, they're actually remaking that into a motion picture. And I believe it's going to encompass three films, which The Stand is one of my favorite Stephen King films, and it'd be really, really nice to see a big budgeted version of that movie. But today's film is one that I saw for the first time a couple of days ago. I'd never even heard of this movie, and I actually picked it up when I saw Stephen King's name on it, and just the cover alone and what it had to say on the back, I thought it sounded pretty interesting. But it's called Desperation. And that's the front cover of it right there, everyone. And here's the back. You can see it there. This one actually came out, I believe, in 2006. And this was actually released on television. It did not have a theatrical release. I guess that's why I missed it, because I'm used to seeing all of Stephen King's films, for the most part, on the movie screen. But this one came out. I had never heard of it. And the funny thing about it is that it was released on television, but at the same time, when I watched it, it had some really gruesome moments in them that I know it couldn't have been shown on television. As a matter of fact, the disc says rated R for violence and gruesome images. And they couldn't show this on TV, but it was released on television. So I'm imagining that they probably filmed all the gruesome scenes and everything and just edited it out. And then when they made it for home video, they put it back in, because it definitely says, even when it comes on, it says rated R. So that's a really interesting thing to do, to edit it for the television release, because then you don't know you're actually missing anything. And then home video, you put everything in it. But even on the home video disc, it doesn't say uncut edition or any kind of special edition. It just says Desperation. And the movie has, what is his name? I know this guy's name. Oh, it has Tom Skerritt in it, who's the main star of the film. And then we have Ron Perlman, who plays this sheriff character there. If I can get him in good focus there. And as a matter of fact, right here, that's Ron Perlman. And basically, guys, this film has a lot, in my opinion anyway, similarities to one of Stephen King's earlier novels, and that's The Stand. Basically, you have a story here that's about good versus evil, which is, you know, pretty much a staple in all of Stephen King's films. But you really have a lot of religious overtones in this film. There's mention of God in this film quite a bit. The nature of God, how God works, how God's actions are kind of over the head of the human characters. They don't understand why he does what he does, why he allows certain things. You see some of the human characters frustrated with God because, you know, they kind of think, well, you know, he can stop this, but he doesn't stop this. Why does he allow this to happen? And so on and so forth. And then, of course, we have a demonic presence in the film as well. But basically, Ron Perlman plays this, and the film starts out, Ron Perlman plays this sheriff of a small town called Desperation. And he keeps incriminating people that he pulls over to where he takes them to jail. And he takes this one guy, at the beginning of the film, he takes this guy and this girl to jail. He just shoots the guy and throws the girl in jail. And when you get to the small town jailhouse, you see he has all these people in jail. And first off, you're wondering, you know, why did he shoot this guy but let the other people live? But he's capturing these people, and then, you know, later on in the film we learn why he's capturing them, and I don't really want to give that away, because if you've never seen the film, that would kind of spoil it. But God, I'm trying to figure out what I can actually say to move ahead with the story without spoiling it. But you have a small kid in the jail also who, from our point of view as audience members, this kid is kind of the representation of God. He's the one that prays, communicates with God. He's a pretty wise kid. He's the only one that actually prays. And, you know, Tom Skerritt's character is the, he's kind of the devil's advocate character. He doesn't believe in praying. He doesn't believe God does anything. And so you have this little kid that has a direct link to God. This kid is also, he has a sister in the film who was actually killed by Ron Perlman's character. And the sister comes back in a ghostly form and helps the kid out, which is her brother, helps him out. Tells him what to do, shows him what's going on. So you have a story that basically has good and evil, and God communicating with this kid through the actions of his deceased sister. And basically, you know, it's kind of almost a story of faith. And that's when I brought up a little bit earlier about The Stand, where in The Stand, the good guys had to believe in God. They had to have faith in all this to conquer the evil in The Stand. And it's the same thing in this story. Basically, the characters learn that, you know, there is a higher power going on. There is a God. And despite the fact that most of the characters don't really buy into it, the little kid is just really faithful. He's a vessel. God is kind of leading him as to what to do in this situation and all that. As a matter of fact, guys, the demon in this story is called Tak, T-A-K. And we see this little flashback early on of how this demon got here. Apparently in this town, in the history of this town, they imprisoned and enslaved Asian people. And they made the Asians do all this tunneling and digging for coal. And they dug up this demonic vessel that held this demon, where someone had imprisoned it, and they released it, and it goes to possessing people and taking them over. And I thought that overall it was a good picture, but I will say that it is very, very talky. You can definitely watch it and tell it's a Stephen King film, because a lot of the elements that's present in this film is present in a lot of Stephen King's films. I did like the movie, but I don't think that it's one of those films that's just going to appeal to a lot of Stephen King fans. As a matter of fact, I do know that fans of the book have complained quite a bit about this film, how it omits and leaves out a lot of things that they felt were really, really should have been in this movie. But then again, I've read some reviews where some people actually enjoyed the movie, and overall I enjoyed the film. It's definitely nothing that just screams out and just says, oh, this is a great movie. But at the same time, it's a even though it has a $12 million budget, it seems like a low budget film. And I've always been the kind of person that kind of liked the influence of good versus evil in the film, and when they throw God into the mix, and, you know, that shows that, you know, even though we might think that God's not involved in the overall scheme of things, in this film he's definitely there, and he's definitely acting through the people. So, you know, even though you have like the one character's little sister dying and the mom screaming, why are you praying, why are you praying, God didn't save your sister, and this and that, it's kind of a movie that brings up the question of faith. Do you believe in God? Do you blame God for, you know, letting the little girl die and all the bad stuff that's happened? Do you see the bigger scheme of things? So it's one of those religious films done by Stephen King, with which is quite strong in religious overtones. Like I said, though, guys, I pretty much enjoyed the film. I like the child character, the little boy that played the link between God and humanity. I did like that character, but at the same time, I could see a lot of people not liking this movie because it is very, very talkative, and sometimes there's not a lot of going on. Now, one of the best things about this film is probably Ron Perlman, who turns in a good performance. And Ron Perlman is one of those actors that, you know, you just like. He's not so varied to me as an actor, but at the same time, he's entertaining. Tom Skerritt, he comes across as an asshole, but at the same time, I felt like they should have made him a much, much stronger asshole to really, you know, be the one that, you know, is objective and not real happy with the scheme of things and all that. But I think they should have made him a lot stronger. But at the same time, overall, a decent cast. I felt that the character should have been developed quite a bit more. And for a Stephen King film, I was a little bit surprised by how little the characters were developed. Because a lot of times, some of Stephen King's best films are made for television miniseries, where they actually get a chance to spend time on these characters. But despite this being a television film, it's just not a lot of character given to the side characters in the movie, then that's kind of odd. But overall, I did enjoy the film. If someone were to ask me would I recommend it, I'm really, really 50-50 on that, guys, because I can see a lot of people not liking it. But I did enjoy Desperation. Just for the fact, mostly, that we have some really, really decent... I like the kid in the film. I like the strong themes of good and evil. I liked all that. But at the same time, logically in this film, there's some things you just have to turn your brain off that just don't make any sense. Just the way the whole demonic force acts in this film, and his scheme, his plan, and all that, just really, it just don't make any sense. And I'm trying not to spoil it, guys. Ron Perlman's whole way of when he's possessed, how he's actually dealing with the people and his plans for the people, you just... and the fact that we have a whole town, a desperation, a whole town where he's actually capturing people, going into this town, throwing them in jail, and no one has... none of these people's families are out looking for them. You know, we have cell phones during this time. None of these people are able to call anybody for help. It's just kind of a stretch of the imagination that, you know, not one person in this film told anybody where they were going to where they would come and look for them. And you think that if you just go missing somewhere, you think that there'd be cops all over this town. Well, you know, my family is gone. They were going through this town and, you know, we haven't seen them. Wherever they were going, the people said they didn't get there, they didn't arrive or nothing. I mean, after a while, after you have all these people missing and someone directing them saying they were going this way, so they would have went through this town, we at least know basically where they were going, you would think that there'd be just FBI all over that town looking for these people. And then, of course, in the town itself, everybody's been wiped out. You see these bodies laying everywhere. And it's just like, you know, that's just, you could not miss that. And the bodies aren't even hidden. Some of them are just propped up in front of stores, sitting in chairs. And there's just no way you could hide that. And that's the biggest flaw of this whole movie, is that you could not hide. It's just like driving through a little town and you see bodies just laying out there up against buildings, dead. You know, the first thing you're going to do is call the cops. And in this film, guys, you actually have dogs that are just sitting on the highway. Dogs. I mean, a good mile, you just see dogs sitting everywhere. And it's like, nobody would think that's strange. But anyway, that's the biggest thing with this film, guys. You got to suspend your belief because the things that I just mentioned, they never explain what's going on. But anyway, can't recommend it, guys, but I enjoyed it for the very basic good versus evil and the heavenly overtones in the film. Anyway, thanks for watching, everybody. If you've seen this film, please let me know what you thought of it. Take care, and I'll see you in the next film review.